अकाउंट होते अपने आप।
नो अनलिमिटेड है वो।
सोहेल जी आर वी रेडी टू गो?
Yes,
I'm ready. ठीक है, मनीष जी question answer right at the end of the session.
ठीक है। It is our privilege to have Sohail ji today among us. Sohail ji has been associated with BNHS, Bombay Natural History Society, and BNHS has been doing a lot of pioneer work in wetland conservation, butterfly conservation, nature conservation all over India. And Sohail ji also has been associated nearly all parts of India. And we know him more because of the butterfly months he's been organizing in the past few years. Last year, जैसे दिल्ली में उन्होंने किया था Delhi Butterfly Month, and उसके बाद उन्होंने Delhi Dragonfly Month हुआ था, Delhi Moth Week किया था, and there were multiple seminars all over Delhi which were held up for all the butterfly, dragonfly, and moth and nature lovers. So he's also been pioneer and in plantation of native trees all over India. He's been leading lot of native tree plantation, jiski hame sakht zarurat hai aaj tak. He has been instrumental in setting up nearly 40 butterfly parks in the region and guiding many of them. He's been also awarded Lifetime Achievement Award in 2019 for his work for dragonfly conservation by the Indian Dragonfly Society. Sohail ji, aapko jaan ke ek khushi hogi ki Noida Floriculture Society has been there for the last 30-40 years, and we have lot many dragonfly lovers among us. There are lot many members who are active into water gardening or butterflies ke saath. We have had the privilege of enjoying the presence of dragonflies also. So now, without taking much time, I would like you, request you to go ahead and enrich us with your knowledge on butterflies.
Thank you, Manish ji, for such a generous introduction. Before I start out, I would like to say that this is an amazing time in. You hardly get to meet dragonfly lovers, and just for that, I would like to tell you that we are celebrating the Dragonfly Festival with WWF India. August 14th we start. So I would like to invite you guys. I will keep you in the loop when that happens.
Sure, sir.
Okay, so let me begin today's session on butterfly gardening. But I would like to start with a scenario, just a short story. Imagine me walking in a desert, and there is no greenery around. There's sand dunes, maybe Jaisalmer somewhere, and no water in sight, no greenery in sight, no wild animal in sight, and no bearing of where I am. When I see a family living in a house, and it's a family of four, suddenly, just by having that much information that there is a family in this vicinity of in this desert, a family of four, then I know that there's potable water at least 2 kilometers or maybe 5 kilometers away. They're growing something, or there's a market, there's a road that services them, or there's electricity wires coming. I can follow the wires and get to civilization. So the idea of this story is looking at things around you gives us understanding of this world that we live in is. Most of our science, most of our understanding, most of our spirituality comes from looking at world around us. That's what people like me do. We look at certain species. So people look at birds, I look at butterflies, some people look at dragonflies. The idea is by looking at these creatures, we can get an idea, or we can get an understanding of what the environment is and what the various biotic factors there are in the environment. Butterflies are especially good for this because they can sense minute changes in our nature, in our surrounding, in our climatic conditions. So scientists have been studying butterflies for their global climate change studies. They give us an idea of the changing environment better than any other creature. But there are lots of examples like this, studying the nature and understanding. Some high-tech examples now are gold mining is done through termites, and there are sniffer bees that dig out bombs. So you can focus on one part of the whole ecosystem and figure out lots of details, because our ecosystem, and that's what butterflies, citizen science around butterflies, looking at butterflies, making butterfly habitat, that's what it's about, and this is how it's contributing to butterfly conservation. Why are butterflies important? Butterflies, as I told you, are indicators of the health of the environment. The one of the best bioindicators, we call them. Second, they're also a very big part of food source. It's part of the food chain, and they make up food source. Birds, spiders, wasps, flies, reptiles, lots of frogs, lots of different beings depend on butterflies as their food source. Second, they're also very important pollinators. They go from one flower to another flower, pollinating most of our plant sources. Right? So this is why butterflies are important. Just to start out our little talk about butterflies. So now that we know why people study butterflies, what is the role of butterflies, and what are butterflies? Butterflies are highly evolved insects. Insects, it means they have three body parts as well as six legs. So that is what constitutes an insect. And what makes butterflies and moths unique in the insect world is that their wings will always have scales. As kids, you might have picked up a butterfly or seen a dead butterfly, and the colors start rubbing off in your fingers. Those are the minute scales of a butterfly, and light falling on it and reflecting back is what gives us the colors. These beautiful colors of butterflies and moths come from these scales. No other insect will have these scales on their wings. So if you want to know if this six-legged flying insect is a butterfly or a moth, you have to check for these scales. If this is such a colorful pattern, it has these scales, right? So this is one thing you need to understand as butterfly gardeners. Second thing you need to understand is, like I said, they're highly evolved insects. That means that they go through a process called metamorphosis. Metamorphosis means going through life stages where you completely change the way you look in all the life stages. Like, we don't go through metamorphosis. Maybe emotional metamorphosis we go through crossing over from puberty, but no physical metamorphosis. We just grow into our bodies. With butterflies, that's not the case. They go through four different stages because they're highly evolved. Some simple insects have two stages, some like dragonflies have three stages, and butterflies have four stages. The simple reason why insects have evolved this strategy is because it's super efficient. What I mean by that is, at every life stage, like in our Vedas, it's written that first you go through brahmachari, then you go to grihastha and all that. So their life is divided into stages. They have done that physically. They have divided life into stages, and every life stage has its own place, and without each, the other won't succeed. Okay, so let me go through these life stages one by one. So it starts off by an egg. Eggs are usually laid in singly or in clusters, and these eggs protect the life inside, and mostly in our area, in about a week's time, they are hatched. The important thing about eggs is that the egg will only be laid on a particular plant for a particular species. Here today, what you see in front of you is a lime butterfly. So, lime butterfly is so called because the host plant on which it's going to lay its eggs is lime. So, most make a host plant for this butterfly. So, it's going to find a plant, find a leaf, and lay its egg. This egg will give birth to a very, very small young larva. This is what we call the caterpillar stage. And in the caterpillar stage, the purpose of the butterfly is only and only to eat. It is a ferocious eating machine. It goes from a very, very small looking young larva to as big as my hand sometimes. So it can grow that much. And every time it grows, it needs to change its outer covering. That outer covering is known as molt. So it goes through 4 to 5 stages. As you can see, this is a young larva of a lime butterfly. It is trying to camouflage as bird poop. As it grows bigger, you cannot have such big bird poop. So it turns into a yellow-green color where it can hide between the leaves of the lime plant. Once it's done eating as much as it can or as much as it wants and gone through all the 4 or 5 instars that it needs to go through, it finds a safe place and makes a thread. This process is called pupation, and the caterpillar turns from this adult larva to what we call a chrysalis. In this, it will just hang next to a wood or a safe spot, let me say, safe spot. And in that safe spot, all the ingredients for the adult butterfly are rearranged from the caterpillar food. What the caterpillar ate, the insides of the butterfly is formed, and it breaks open this chrysalis. There's a change of color right before it's going to open up, and it comes out a very wet butterfly. This wet butterfly needs to find sunny spot to dry itself off, to pump butterfly blood into its veins and stretch out the wings. Once it's an adult butterfly, the butterfly that we want in our gardens, that butterfly is not bothered about eating, is not about making friends. The only thing this butterfly wants to do is find a mate and lay its eggs. That is the purpose of an adult butterfly. So if you want, we have this impression that butterflies come to flowers. That is not mostly true, because for butterflies, flowers is just a energy drink. This energy helps her find the particular host plant and its mate. That is all it's trying to do. So most importantly for us today, butterfly garden is supposed to have these host plants. Butterfly can lay its egg. The habitat should be conducive enough that it can hide while it's an adult and while it's in all these stages. And thirdly, it needs to have a few flowers where it can be. And the flowers don't matter. It just matters that there should be nectar-rich flowers. So roses won't do. Rose doesn't have any nectar. So some flowers which are just highly ornamental won't do. We need nectar in these flowers. Okay, so now we understand a little bit about butterflies, as much as we want to know for making a butterfly garden. Let me move on to the garden itself. For the garden, We need to create an ideal ecosystem. What I mean by an ideal ecosystem is a part of the forest. Like we used to, in olden times, have these Ashok Vatika or these gardens, which were pre-time. They were a snapshot of the forest that you see, which is just safer because there were so many animals, wild animals in the forest. It wasn't safe to be in the forest. So people made these kind of gardens, which were not artificial. They were part of the forest. It looked like the forest. It had the same plant and it had the same biodiversity. How we do go about doing such a thing is, first, we use no poisons. What I mean by that is no chemical pesticides, insecticides. Anything you use to kill any other organism, even if you want to get rid of flies, if you want to get rid of mosquitoes, any other organism, it will also affect the butterfly, the caterpillars, the larva, the chrysalis of our butterflies, of course. So it will have bioaccumulation effect and it will kill most of the insect biodiversity in our gardens. So poisons are a big no-no. We let nature keep its checks and balances. Biological control is established where no organism gets to go out of control. So if we have mosquitoes, then dragonflies need to be there. They will kill the dragons, the mosquitoes. Same way, if you have lots of butterflies, then you will have lots of birds and other spiders and lizards coming and eating them. That is part of building a butterfly garden. The third thing is that we have to plant natives. By natives, I mean plants endemic to our area. We live in Delhi, which is for the ecological landscape of Delhi is on the banks of Yamuna as well as Aravali Ridge Forest. So a mix of these plant types, of these habitat, is what natives is for us. Why we insist on choosing natives is because most of the insects around us have a long evolutionary relationship with these plants. So a lime plant took to laying its eggs on a nimbu long time ago, and that makes it important that we keep these plants if we want these butterflies. If we get a plant from South America, we will need insects from South America. So we need, for our indigenous insect population, we need to plant natives. Very important to understand. The last two points are somewhat similar. What we need to, as gardeners, begin to do is adopt less intrusive methods. Less control over what we are doing in our gardens. Less chopping, less de-weeding. We don't want to change the soil structure. We don't want to cut out prune plants mercilessly. We need to have wild spots, wild patches where we let our gardens be, let nature do its work, get introduced more and more grasses, wildflowers, wild plants, which in most cases are also host plants for butterflies. So there is a requirement of change of mindset, not in just in our gardening methods, but also our mindset in how we look at gardens. When we look at gardens and we see a lot of flowers, we feel really happy. But we have to start looking beyond that and think about beauty of a garden in the biodiversity that it holds. So a green piece of plot holds a lot of biodiversity apart from the flora. So there is a lot of insects that are going to depend on it, the birds are going to, in spiders, lizards. All this is part of the beauty of a garden, and that's the mindset I'm talking about. Some practical considerations, you guys know this better than me, that you need to understand if you're building a garden or a habitat. You need to understand the climate of the area. You need to understand Delhi has harsh summers and very cold winters, so our plants need to survive. Second, we need to understand what kind of soil conditions there are. And thirdly, how the light passes through my plot. Sun sets in the east, sun rises in the east, sets in the west, and that gives my plot or my site different light conditions, which the light passes through this area in different parts of the day, and we need to understand that to make a design to plot. There's somebody's mic is on.
क्या कर सकते हैं, हट गया जैसा मेरे अंदर जाना.
Somebody's mic is on.
Let me.
This is just a representation of the biogeographic areas in India. As you can see, we lie somewhere here, which is, like I said, between the Gangetic plains, which is Yamuna flood bank is part of it, and the semi-arid Aravalli forest. So this is our biogeography in India. Now, ABC of butterfly gardening. It's very, very simple. We first start out with a local area survey and prepare a butterfly list. What I mean by that is you just go around your area and see which kind of butterflies you see there. And it doesn't need to be in your garden. Any place like Lodi Garden or in Noida, if there are places where you see a lot of butterflies, just go and see which species. Make a note of which species. You can even get lots of online resources of the types of butterflies you see in Delhi NCR. Once you have this butterfly list, you have to make a host plant list according to the species that you have. All the species that you want to attract to your garden will be these local butterflies, and these local butterflies will have a corresponding host plant each. Once you have a list of the butterflies and the host plants, the third thing is sourcing the plants, and one of the toughest things to do. Why? Because most nurseries are not into keeping such plants. There's deep reasons for that. Most people are looking for flowers, or most people are looking for exotic plants. These flowers, these butterfly plants that we're talking about are such common local native plants that they're hard to find now. But these are a few places where, so if you want like common and garden varieties, you can get to private nurseries for such kind of plants. If you want the uncommon and local tree varieties, there are about 14 government nurseries in Delhi where plants are distributed for free. Then if you would like to plant some rare and native varieties, for that you will actually either have to grow them from seed on your own, or their local initiatives. I have a nursery. Aravalli Biodiversity Park, Gurgaon has a nursery. Mission 100 Trees. There's somebody in Noida also who has a, I'm not sure about the name right now, who has a nursery where you can pick up these rare native varieties. Then the fourth category is wild flowers, wild plants. These plants are free, readily available, growing everywhere in your backyard, in your on the side of the road, but we don't pay any heed to them. Lots of butterflies use them as their host plants, so they are a very important component of your butterfly garden, of your the list of plants you're going to work on. And one of the best things about these kind of plants is they easily seed. So you can also pick the seeds and bring them home, and they will easily take to ground and are very, very, they don't take much effort to maintain. Like I've already discussed, the elements of a DIY butterfly garden. One is host plants for your caterpillar, nectar plants for your butterfly, and wild patches. Patches where there is no disturbance, no chemicals, where you don't do anything, let everything overgrow. These places will be used by the butterfly to hide in its adult stage, as well as when it's in its pupal stage or its larva stage, it will be using these patches. So caterpillar host plants, butterfly nectar plants, and wild patch. If you're making a home butterfly garden, the thing to understand is this is a place for you to connect with nature. Looking at butterflies is not just for conservation, not just for science. It's also therapeutic. It's a stealth program to de-stress you. So look at it like that. This is a good hobby to just look at butterflies and admire their beauty. We are lucky that such a good pastime also can help the conservation of these beauties. So this has to be a harmonious and exciting environment for you. And everything about the design process is just illustrative and not restrictive. You can bring in your creativity and do wonders to the garden. You just have to remember that you need to have the ABC of the butterfly garden. You need to have the elements of a butterfly garden, like the host plants, the host plant for caterpillar, the nectar plants, as well as a wild patch. Before you begin planting, you need to define your spaces. You need to know where they're going to be open spaces and where they're going to be dense planted spaces. And this helps you with the overall plantation scheme of your plot. So a very important process to keep in mind before you start out making your garden. Next is the creative elements that you can put in. They can be of two types, vertical and horizontal elements. So some of the horizontal elements are lawn, bench, ledge, lily pond, ground cover. Some of the vertical elements are trees, creepers, screens, hanging pots, trellis, and garden ornaments. This is just for the beauty of the place and has nothing to do with the habitat. This is how you are going to connect. First, you provide a habitat to the butterflies, then you provide beauty to the place, and then you work towards a connection between you and that physical space. And this is what a butterfly garden is. Some things I would like to say about the colors. Not very important when you're planting for butterflies. This is just for your own pleasure. So you can be as creative as you want. The only thing that I told you have to remember is that the flowers you use are not hybrid flowers, are rich in nectar. And you can experiment as much as you want with the color scheme, and every year have different, your butterfly garden look different. Another thing that you should pay attention to is texture and form. But is simply what this I mean, that whenever you're planting host plants, make sure that it is in clumps of nectar and host. So the butterfly is very territorial, does not fly long distances. It will stay close to its host plant. So if you have a host plant of a certain butterfly, best to have nectar plants right next to it, so the energy source is not too far away. So planting in such clumps is always most efficient. And try and be as diverse in your choice. Plant selection, you should have succulents also, foliage plants also, ground cover also. Try and visualize the textures here. Like you can see in a dry, rocky place, I've planted aloe vera, which goes vertically up. And here, these are these bulbs, which the leaves are drooping down, which is next to a very small pond. So you're trying to give design elements to the spaces that you have. Drooping leaves look better next to water, while drier landscapes look better with these leaves of aloe vera going up. So that's just an example of texture and form. Some of the additional design elements that you can put into your butterfly garden, which are actually very essential for the butterfly's life cycle, are a mud patch. Mud patch means any wet mud area in your garden. You put some cow dung, keep watering it every 8 hours, depending on the climate. Every 8 hours, you just try and keep it wet. Butterflies take nectar and energy from the flowers for their essential nutrients that they need, like salts and other elements. They go to such wet patches and put their proboscis in and try and suck in these elements through the water. So it happens in mud patch also. It happens on rotten fruit also. It happens on wet rocks also. So these are three things you can keep in your garden to attract additional butterflies. Plus, you should remember to always have sheltered space, wind breaks. Butterflies don't like windy places. Third, you should have strata variation. By that I mean planting should be done from ground level to the canopy level. Just planting shrubs or just planting trees would not do, because most butterflies have different stratas that they occupy. Small butterflies, you will usually see them flying 6 inches or a foot above the ground, and big butterflies are flying above the tree canopy level. So need to have all the strata planted so as to attract most diversity of butterflies. This is a small activity that you can start out with. It's you choose any three categories from below. These are categories of plants that you have here. Choose any three categories from below and try and find one host, one nectar plant and one wild variety that you can plant in your garden. How you could do that is, these are, I will share this after the presentation also. These are few resources that you can go to online. This is I Found Butterflies. This is an Indian website where you can easily find larval host plants for your butterfly species that you have recorded or that you, the list that you have prepared. Second, these websites, this is National History Museum UK. You can find from the butterfly to the host plant and also from the host plant to the butterfly. So if you want to find out if any, like a jasmine is a host for any butterfly, just type in the name of the flower. It will tell you if it's a host of any butterfly or not. Then you can see if that butterfly is local to your area or not. Or you can go the other way around. You can have the list of a butterfly. You can have the name of the butterfly and find out what is the larval host plant for it. And these websites also have pictures, and the best part about them is they are contributed. The contributors for such a website are people like you and me. Normal citizens are contributing, and this is what citizen science is: contribution of data. And then somebody places it in such a way that it is free to use for people like me and you again, who are interested in getting to know about butterflies. So this is some few resources you should check out before you make a butterfly garden. Now let me just go over a few host plants and nectar plants which can be seen easily in our area, and you can easily procure them to your balcony or to your terrace or to your colony garden, and this will surely attract a lot of butterflies. Sometimes we don't have faith when we look at these plants. We're like, I have never seen butterflies on such plants. But that's not the case. Once you start looking for butterflies, once you know where they are, these caterpillars, you will find them. Okay. So with that, let me go to the first one. First one is kadi patta. We are all familiar with kadi patta. Kadi patta is responsible for, I would say, 50% of Delhi people get into butterflies because of kadi patta. Kadi patta attracts this very beautiful black and white butterfly called common mormon. And I would say if there is a kadi patta, a healthy kadi patta near you, please do look for common mormon butterfly. But if you find a common Mormon butterfly, if you see a common Mormon butterfly flying anywhere in Delhi NCR, anywhere, stop and look for a kadi patta. There will definitely be a kadi patta around it. So kadi patta is a good plant to start off with for your butterfly garden. Next is a medicinal plant we call Pilo Vajadanti. That is a porcupine flower. This is native to our area. You can see it flowering profusely in winters, that happens. This is a host plant for a lot of pansies around in our area. Yellow pansy, lemon pansy are a few that you can see using this plant as a host plant. And you can see a caterpillar here for pansy. This is the best time to look for caterpillars of pansy. This till September, October, you will find a lot of them in this porcupine flower. Next is a commonly used ornamental hedge in our city, in Noida too, in Delhi also, called Inermi hedge. Most gardens, most parks have this hedge. And this hedge is host plant for a butterfly called common silver line. This is a small butterfly as small as my thumbnail. And the caterpillar is green looking like this. You can see here the photograph. And it uses such bushy hedges to lay its eggs on. Next is Pathar Chatta, or even Bryophyllum. It's called as Bryophyllum, or even some varieties of Calincho. Our host plant to this beautiful small butterfly called the red pyro. This butterfly is one of the few leaf miners where, because we know Calincho and Pathar Chatta are succulents, they have these thick leaves. What the caterpillar does is, it burrows itself inside the leaf and keeps eating from one direction and pooping from the other direction and lives its life inside the leaf itself. Once it becomes a chrysalis, you can see this one here is a chrysalis. Once it wants to become a chrysalis, it comes out of the leaf and just sticks itself to this leaf. And here it has come out, left its case behind and become this beautiful butterfly. So if you're looking for red pyro caterpillars in your Pathar Chatta or Calincho, you should be looking for leaves which have these brown patches, and those brown patches is where the caterpillar is sitting and eating. This we have already seen, Nimbu, and there's this lime blue butterfly also. They both use our local Mosambi or other big lemon or the small lemon. So all sorts of citrus fruits, citrus trees are used by the lime butterfly. Next is what we call a zebra blue butterfly. So named because of this zebra pattern on its wing. This is also a very, very small butterfly. And its host is these two plants. One is Chitrak, which is the white flumbago, which is local native to our area. The other one is the ornamental one called the blue flumbago. And the caterpillar, you see this bush and lots of flowers here. Very, very hard to find the caterpillar because the caterpillar is here. A very small caterpillar, green, white colored, hiding inside the flower bud. Here you can see these buds on the white flumbago, and inside these buds is this small little creature. So if you know where to look, you will be able to find these caterpillars. And this is a good plant to have in your garden for inviting zebra blues. Another is passion flower vine, and the host plant is the host plant is passion flower vine, and the butterfly is Tawny Coster. This is also a butterfly which is actually used as an indicator for knowing if cow grazing is happening. So by some weird coincidence, grazing happening, you see a lot of Tawny Coster. Next is this Aravali specialist plant of ours called Kanthari or wild caper bush. Capparis is one family of plants which host a lot of Aravalli butterflies. So Capparis sepia, decidua, lots other bushes and shrubby plants in the caper family are host to a lot of butterflies in our area. Okay, one of the most common butterflies you can find in our gardens is the plains cupid. It is common because of this plant called the sago palm, which is also called the cycas. Excuse me. This is a cycas in my balcony. The cycas has these new leaf growths that grow from middle of the plant, and that's where the egg is laid. And the interesting thing about this caterpillar of plains cupid is that it is tended by ants, and ants protect it, keep it clean, as well as for that service they take something the caterpillar exudes from its behind. It's a liquid which is also ironically called honeydew, and this is what the ants feed on. So for that honeydew, it keeps the caterpillar safe. And if you find a lot of ants in your cycas plant, it is an indication that there are lots of caterpillars for plains cupid. Another common butterfly that you see is the Indian palm borb, and the Indian palm borb is usually found on pygmy date palm or the cane palm, which is again commonly used in our gardens. This is what the egg looks like, small 1 millimeter egg. And the caterpillar has a habit of cutting up these leaves and folding them and living inside that. So if you see a cane palm or a pygmy date palm, which has these irregular cuts, and that leaf is tied together, that is an indication that it has these caterpillars. And of course, when you know there's caterpillars, no pesticides, no insecticides have to be used. Sometimes you even have to keep the birds away. The next butterfly is the most commonest butterfly in Delhi, called the plain tiger butterfly, a very strong, resilient butterfly. The host plant for it is called milkweed or auk. Safed auk, or there is also Calotropis procera, which has those blue flowers instead of white flowers. This is usually found easily in degraded landscapes and grows like a jungly plant. It has this special alkaloid which the caterpillar feeds on, which makes the plain tiger adult not very palatable or not very tasty. So most birds don't eat it. So this is a defense mechanism for this butterfly. Because it's not tasty, most birds and lizards and predators don't eat it. That is why it's so bold and abundantly found. It's not very afraid, and it is abundantly found because it has not many predators want to eat it. Another common plant is the common castor plant, which is also called arundi, and it has a butterfly, a brown color butterfly that you see here, which is its host plant. So this is also found commonly in our nalas, everywhere where there is a little bit of water, you will find these. But every year we are cutting most of them and they regrow. It's a futile exercise. It's best to have them grow in a place and have big strands of them, and they also support a lot of castor butterflies. So you keep them like that. Another is the Ashok plant, and Ashok plant hosts this beautiful blue looking butterfly called the common jay. And common jay, you can see all the three instars here. It starts with the orange one, becomes black, then becomes green. Usually found on upper canopies of the Ashoka, and very, very common if you go around Delhi at certain times. We just missed the common jay time, the first. Now, in the spring, again, you'll be able to see a lot of these common jays. Few trees that you should keep in mind which are disappearing from Delhi. are also host plants that I would like to mention here are this one called Pilu, which is the miswak or the toothbrush tree. It's a very good tree, old living slow growing tree. It's also, the fruit is edible and very, very tasty. The other is Calasiris, and this Alvesia lebec is also a host plant for a lot of species of butterflies and a native to our area and disappearing, and then not so many here. Then Amaltas cassia family is also host to these big yellow butterflies that you see around your area now, which are called the immigrant butterflies, as well as Belpatra, which is also has religious significance in our area. Another host plants are bear and Capparis decidua, again fruiting. Even Capparis decidua is kher, which or kareem, which people, even this fruit is edible. People make achar from it, as far as I know. I've eaten the achar, but not eaten the fruit. It's a little bitter. Moving on to nectar plants. Some, I know you, all of you are with this society for a long time, and you know more about flowers than I could even begin to imagine. But let me give you a few overlooked common plants that you can have in your garden, which are favorites for butterflies. So this is the first one called coat button, which is Tyrex procumen, which the small flower looks like a small sunflower or a daisy, and very gregarious. Just take the seed and put it somewhere, it'll grow on its own, and a favorite for a lot of butterflies. This is Verdelia, one of the plants you can use as ground cover. And in this, again, it grows profusely. You don't need to, once planted, you don't need to replant. It flowers profusely and is used by butterflies a lot, loved by butterflies. Then there's Desi Genda and Sadabahar, which both, again, butterflies love. Then there's this exotic called the Jamaican Spike. This is also, it doesn't take much space, gives a lot of flowerets. And these flowerets are loved by big butterflies, like this small moon butterfly that you see. Next is this verbena, what we call, this is usually sold as verbena. There's a verbena sold as a seasonal variety. This is not that seasonal variety. This is the perennial plant, and very hardy plant. If you just keep giving it, don't let it dry out, it will flower all year round and used by butterflies a lot. Next is what we call the floss flower or the blue weed. This is a weed which in North America, this is grown as an ornamental plant. But here, if you go into the countryside, next to the roads or anywhere, next to tube wells, anywhere there's lots of water, this grows profusely. And this is a favorite for tiger butterflies. You can see a blue tiger, you can see a plain tiger to grow. Very easy to maintain and attracts a huge number of butterflies, as you can see in the photographs. The last two plants that I would like to mention are, they're not used by butterflies for either nectar or as host plants. Here, the use is a little different. Butterflies come to these plants to extract chemicals out of them. These chemicals help them attract females. So, usually visited by male butterflies. So one is this Calotropis. The other is what we call a turnsole plant. These plants, you will usually find a lot of tiger butterflies on them, and they are scratching the stem of it and trying to suck in the chemicals that are there in the plant. And like I told you, use for pheromones. The only thing that you have to keep in mind if you're planting turnsole is that turnsole is toxic and highly allergic for dogs. So if you have pets at home, please don't plant tonsil plant. Okay, with this, I would like to end my talk, open the floor for questions. And my contact information is given right here, the email address and phone number. Please do not hesitate to get in touch with me if you feel you have some questions, or if you feel you need some advice on starting up, or if you need some of these plants. I would be happy to help you in any which way I can. Thank you, and let's have some questions.
Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful session.
I'll just put that slide so people can take a picture, or the important thing in this whole presentation that will set you on to the path. Slide. So if you can all see this slide, please take a picture, or I can even send it out to you, Mani sir, and then you can share it amongst the group. This is where you will find the host plant resources. And if you need a list of butterflies, I can supply that list. It's not so tough.
And there is one question, Sohail ji, regarding this when you mentioned the cycas plant.
Yes.
See, most of the people at that time, when the new leaves are coming out, find that the leaves are getting destroyed as such, you know, because as you said, the ants and the caterpillars are there. Now,
yes.
The problem is they end up using chemicals to save the new leaf. They think,
yes.
You know, is there any way of tackling it naturally by not also not letting the plant get affected, because the growth comes only once a year, and then if it gets damaged, everybody gets into a panic, you know, like plant kharab ho gaya kya kare, and then you have all the chemicals being advised for that. Although we tell them to stick with vinegar and some dish liquid, you know, a gentle version, dilute it and then spray it, probably it won't be affected. But that would probably push the butterflies away, won't it?
So yes, exactly. So ma'am, this is... Yeah, a very, very important question, and I'm glad you started with this only, because I have been making a lot of these habitats all over Delhi, and this is usually with this cycas. This is where our first, stumble is. The thing that we have to remember is, if we want the new leaves to come, then we have to sacrifice the butterflies. And if we want the butterflies to come, we have to sacrifice the new leaf. The thing that I talked about was biocontrol. What we sometimes forget is that the plant itself is also working on not getting affected. Like our body, when we are affected by something, our immunity kicks in and antibodies start developing for just that reason, to fight off that that disease or that infestation. So if the plant feels that this is an infestation which will not help it survive, then it will actively work in a way where these butterflies cannot proliferate, like that it cannot go out of control. So we have to, like I said, start having this change in mindset where we start believing that biocontrollers will work. Like I, in my cycas, don't do anything. And sometimes there is new leaves are destroyed, all of them. But most of the time, all of them are not destroyed. That's in the nature of the butterfly to think of the plant also. Caterpillar, only a few species of butterflies which are local migrants will finish off all the leaves, because they know if they finish off all the leaves, then there will be no plant next time. And if there's no plant next time, there is, that's the only thing you can do for your future generation. If you're a butterfly, you're never going to meet your offspring. So the only thing you can do is to keep that plant safe and make that plant selection properly, that this plant will keep be healthy, remain so that I will not kill it. If I kill it, then there will be no future generation of it. So we have to remember, it might look like the new leaves are dying and all of them will be killed, but if you don't do anything, some of the new leaves do survive. And you get a lot of butterflies also. So it's a trade-off. And you have to get into the mindset of butterfly gardening with this trade-off in mind.
The corollary to this is, are there any other type of companion plants which we could place around the cycas for the butterflies to go to the other ones rather than just to the cycas? So it's a peculiar butterfly which goes.
Peculiar butterfly, peculiar to cycas.
Because that's the maximum question we have at this time of the year. All the members' queries that come is all related to this only. My cycas is getting damaged. What do I do?
Tell them that cycas is not getting damaged. Your balcony is being turned into a butterfly garden.
That's a positive way of looking.
Yes, that's basically that's
the generally. Generally, what happens, the cycas is one of the main attractions of any garden that we have, you know, especially when it's old and it keeps off giving those leaves. So we really look forward to having the entire bunch of leaves rather than having them, you know, eaten by butterflies or larvae. So that is the main concern. And even I was wanting to ask you this, that if we have any companion plants which we can plant just next to our cycas, which would, you know, dissuade them from eating those very leaves. No, but you said no.
Not for play. So that butterfly is looking for cycas. So it will find your cycas or not find it. So if you spray it or something, then it will not find it. It will go somewhere else. But if it's there, it will find it and it will, yeah. It's a very common butterfly and yeah. So there's no thing that you can, so it is specific to, if we all spray all the cycas palms, then these butterflies will go away.
Okay, so talking about spraying, supposing we are using like neem oil and stuff, even that will deter the butterflies from coming then? That means we should not spray anything at all?
That's the ideal situation, ma'am. Let me tell you what I mean by that. So, a kadi patta plant,
yeah,
we'll have these caterpillars of common mormon. If it has some infestation and I put some neem oil or something on it, the taste of the leaf itself till the neem oil is there is not going to be edible for the common mormon caterpillar. So either it will starve or go to another kadi patta plant.
Okay, so it's advisable not to do any foliar spray, but to have it in the soil only, whatever you want to put in the
soil.
That
is the only thing that you can do.
Okay.
For short term, that you can put stuff in the soil.
All right. Thank you.
Because the foliage is what they depend on. Mm-hmm.
Deepa, all questions?
Yeah. Is it true that the hibiscus is also one of the good plants to attract butterflies?
No.
No? Okay. Then there's another question.
I'll tell you. Explain that. So there is a hibiscus variety which is local to our area called Gudel.
Yeah.
So Gudel is very, very, a very good plant for butterfly, nectaring plant. But most other hibiscus, which are these hybrids, yellow, purple, all these colors, they are usually, as you mix and match them, you're looking for beauty and not for nectar. So the nectar content goes down. So most of these hybrid plants, flowers don't have any nectar or very little nectar. So if you're planting that dirty pink variety, that's good. But if you're planting other varieties, it's not good.
Okay, then there's a question. Do different butterflies have different breeding season?
Yes. Yes.
So well, that would be another detailed session, I guess, to find out how it goes.
So basically, ma'am, when we talk to scientists, we believe that everything is known, but it is also this some most like the first person to even tell us that there are four life stages of a butterfly was a French lady in the 16th century. Before that, we didn't even know that. So lots of host plants are not known. Lots of complete life cycles are not known. Insects are the least studied organism, in which probably butterflies are the most studied. And then also, we don't have much information. So I can tell you about most butterflies in that detailed session that you're talking about, but it will still not be complete information because that needs a lot of research. We need a lot of research in butterflies.
Okay. Mr. Madan, then there's this question regarding how to attract butterflies to a balcony garden.
Like I said, this is for a balcony garden only. So this can be done in a park, in a big habitat or a balcony. I, in my home, have a balcony garden. I have like some 12 host plants. All these pictures were of the small host plants were from my garden itself.
Oh.
Yeah, so I grow these plants in pots. Let me show you.
Could you just repeat the, if you can show the photographs again? Suchita ji, pet honeybee, I couldn't understand your question.
Nahin, jaise bees ko hum wo karte hain na, usi tarah se butterflies bhi karein.
जैसे बीहाइव रख लेते हैं ना हम अपने फार्म पे या कहीं पर, तो उस तरीके उसी तरीके से लाइक बटरफ्लाई के लिए भी कोई प्रोविजन है क्या?
ओ,
दिस इज अ क्रिसलिस फ्रॉम माय गार्डन, कड़ी पत्ता पे कॉमन मॉर्म. Just keep these plants, the kadi patta, auk, pila vajadanti, nimbu, cycas.
And gudal.
Gudal, yeah, gudal.
These are some of the very common plants. And I think sabke paas honge. All of us must be identifying with almost 90% of these plants that you
exactly,
named.
Exactly.
अच्छा मिस्टर मदान, फिर एक और
क्वेश्चन है. You just have to start looking for those caterpillars.
Okay.
There's a question that how much time taken by a butterfly to complete its life cycle from egg to adult? This is from a science teacher.
Okay, so it is different for different species, but on an average from 2 months, from 1 month to 3 months. It varies from species to species.
Okay. Then there's a question by one of our members that can we develop something like a hive? Anyway, we can keep butterflies. Like we have a beehive.
Are you talking about enclosures?
Possibly, because she was referring to a beehive, you know, that honeybees you can have in your farms like a bee in a beehive. Is there anything like you can also have?
Bees live in a hive. Butterflies live in a wild patch. So the more wilderness you have, more grass or unmowed lawn or patches, that's where the butterfly is going to hide and live. Whereas a bee is going to live in hives. So for butterflies, there is no such particular thing. And making enclosures like Singapore has a butterfly garden, which is enclosed, all that is illegal in India. You can't keep butterflies captive.
Okay. I don't see any more questions. But Vivek, can we have everybody
yeah, sure.
on for the the photograph like we do always?
Yeah, sure.
Can I stop sharing my screen?
Yes, please. Yeah, that's better. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This was an excellent session, Sohailji. Everybody seems to be spellbound, you know, otherwise. And all the questions are going to crop up, you know, later on when this sinks in, because we've never had such a fascinating topic earlier. So I guess all of us are spellbound, and we are so close to having these butterflies in our gardens. Only with a little bit of care, we can have them, because the plants are already there.
Exactly,
so I think with your talk, we have understood the logics of having, you know, butterflies in our garden and make
that's
it
more what beautiful. Was important. That's what I wanted to convey, that especially to such a group, you're all gardeners, it should be, it's the easiest type of gardening. You don't the less you do, the more the butterflies are going to
the
be
more and the
all the plants you guys know, and it, that's why I was so interested that maybe like you can make better butterfly gardens than me, I believe, because you have so much experience. You just need that logic, like you said, about why the butterflies are going somewhere.
Yeah.
Understand that. That's all.
See, what happens is lantana and all, which used to grow wild, we all plugged it out and moved it away, saying it's a jungly yam. And I remember seeing the maximum butterflies hovering around that lantana bush only.
Yes.
So now I think we should all start reviving those old plants, which we very happily plugged and thrown away, and bring them back to our garden. Yeah. Thank you again, Sohailji. We'll disturb you. Disturb
Manish
you, we'll trouble you.
My pleasure.
We'll trouble you. Manish ji.
हाँ जी
चलो जी भाई
धन्यवाद कर दे
सोहेल जी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद it was always an interesting session as always and I think we हम लोगों के पास तो ज्यादातर लोगों के पास एक अच्छी चीज है आपने बोला था कि द टफेस्ट पार्ट इज सोर्सिंग द प्लांट्स एंड फॉर्चुनेटली फॉर अस इज वी हैव ऑल दोस प्लांट्स अशोक तो ज्यादातर घरों में अशोक का तो बाउंड्री पे लगा ही हुआ है हम लोग के पास और तो वी हैव मोस्ट ऑफ द प्लांट्स नाउ वी हैव द विजन वी हैव नाउ द नॉलेज So probably we should be making you proud with filling up Noida with more of butterflies now.
Yes, sir. I will also send you a list of plants with their butterfly photographs.
Oh, that's good. Very helpful.
You can share it
that would be really good.
That would be great.
And Sohailji, for your information, this session will be put up on our YouTube channel in a day or two. Please do look and share it with your friends.
Absolutely, ma'am. Just share the link with me. I will share it in my group also.
Yeah. It was a pleasure to have you with us.
Thank
and
you
we
so
would
much.
Look for, and we would look forward for to you for you on the birds and the dragonfly.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Don't worry. Dragonfly, something very close to have.
Okay. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. All right, ma'am.
Bye-bye. 1 minute and another 3 questions suddenly. No, okay. Everybody was thanking you. Okay. Okay, bye.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Thank you for paying attention.